I said, I have no idea, but I want to be a part. So he gives us just a need to know basis. He doesn't give us a schedule, but whatever he is doing is good and it's beneficial, amen, to those around us and ourselves. So anyways, people come in from the foyer, hint, hint. We're going to get started with our main event. We are a family around here, and so we love to be together on Sunday and be around each other, fellowship together, eat afterwards. And so it's a time to get to know each other. I'm tired of religion. I don't want to just come in, pat your back, and not see you for a week. I want to be able to get to know you. Amen? So we love people, and you know, Lou always says, if you're okay with people being jacked up, this is the place to be. We're all jacked up, all right? I just heard somebody say, well, I'm not. Okay, whatever. Anyway, all right. Well, we have a lot of things that are happening. Now, we have something that is not in the bulletin that's happening this week. This week at the warehouse. The warehouse is a ministry extension of the river. And it's a give and take ministry, okay? And so this Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, do you know what's happening? We're having a warehouse rummage sale this Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Now, that's exciting. It raises money for our ministry here at the river. But, Trini, you can sit down, honey. You can sit down. And so, but we need volunteers, okay? So we need people to help finish sorting. We have so much stuff, it's just incredible. So we need people to sort. We need people to be there to help and interact with people, because the warehouse is not just a place of blessing and raising finances, but it's a place of ministry. And so we have people all the time. Somebody came by the other day, and Lou and Allie actually were able to pray for a lady. So we want you and need you to be involved, okay? So who here, just quickly, would say, I can volunteer an hour or two or something this week at the warehouse. You see that, Terry? Terry, you see that? Okay. So get together with Terry back there. Terry's raising her hands. So get together with her, and so we need your help, okay? Because we of course, you know, we're going to be selling, and we need that. Okay, excellent. Thank you for your help. Now, this week we have a lot of birthdays, and we have one anniversary. All right, so let's see, what's that? A lot of birthdays. Right, so let's see, Derek, I don't see Derek here. Fiona Pond, you want to come on up? Brandon Foote, come on up. See, shared by Pastor Jim. Come on up. Come on up. Hers is the anniversary. We're going to separately. Okay. So Pastor Jim and who else? We need a Brandon. Okay. All right, Pastor. Come on. All right. Pastor Jim, we need you up here. What? It says the 7th. Is that next Sunday? Okay, well, wait. You get off the hook. We'll do it next Sunday. Okay. All right. So I'll help you out here, Fiona. Okay. Let's all sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
But Anna and Justin's anniversary, 3rd anniversary is this week. So that's exciting. Okay. All right. Oh, Anna, come on up and we'll sing happy anniversary with you. We know Justin's not here yet. But yeah, well, sure. giving them my information because I don't want to be embarrassed. Oh, come on and do it anyway. All right. Okay. Well, this Wednesday is the first Wednesday of the month. Okay, kids, Pastor Lori's talking, so you need to be quiet. Trinity, can you sit down, honey? Okay, so this Wednesday is the first Wednesday of the month, and what that means is that we have Tending the Heart Ladies Group. So we meet every first and third Wednesday of the month. So please join us at Sizzler at 6:30 on Lancaster. We have a wonderful time. We're going over an excellent book called Nurture by Lisa Bevere. Excellent, excellent book. So we look forward to having you. All right. Now, we have a couple testimonies this morning. I'm so excited. You know, we've been speaking that this is the year of prosperity. And I tell you what, the testimonies are coming in just to testify to that. So we had... Donnie, do you have one? You said you had a testimony you want to share? Praise report. Okay, come on up. And then who else did we have? We had, Cher, that's right. Okay, come on up. All right, so what we do is we just give a short testimony or word of encouragement or whatever it is, just to encourage each other. Okay.
So I know that everybody's been praying for me and my family, and I was like, Lord, what am I going to do with all my stuff? And so yesterday I got the help that I was not expecting, but praise God, I got all my stuff out of this other house, and I'm so glad and so excited because there's no burden there anymore. So thank you for your prayers, and thank you for all your help.
Amen. Man, teamwork. All right. Pastor Shane, you had something as well. Okay.
So the reason why the computer crashed was because of me. You can blame me if you want. But if you're a Christian, you'll forgive me. I'm just saying. Just saying. All right. And for those of you who don't know me, I'm Pastor Shannon, and I do the children's church. And we have been memorizing the books of the Bible. Honestly, parents and guests, I want to know how many of you actually know the books of the Bible, all 66 books. Raise your hand if you know them. Oh, children, look at this, children, look at this. So, without further ado, we would like to sing to you the books of the Bible. We're not really all that great singers, but we are children. So remember that if you're Christian, too. So children, will you come up here and join me and stand up here in the middle, and we're going to pray over together.
If a couple of y'all could take pictures while we're doing this so we can post it on Facebook. Mikey, did you want to come up? Okay.
Come on and sing the B-I-B-L-E.
What an inspiration, amen? I'll tell you what, if you have not yet ever physically gone and thanked Pastor Shannon or Angie or any of the others that work to teach your children, please make that a point to go in and thank them, because they work tirelessly, and sometimes they are tired by the end of the day, but they are a blessing to our children, amen, to us. Hallelujah. All right, we have a couple more testimonies. Miss Cher, come on up. On behalf of her and Rod, she has a testimony. I'm so excited.
I am too. My husband's parents own a house at the beach, and both of them have been going for quite a number of years, and we tried to sell the house. But every time we put them on the market, there were no nibbles. And so we were thinking, oh my gosh, what are we going to do, Lori? You know, it's starting to deteriorate. We need somebody in it. So I began praying earnestly and asking others to pray and stand with me that the house would sell, because, you know, my sister-in-law and brother-in-law would have to come out from Florida every year. And, you know, there's just a lot to be taken care of. So we put it on the market a few months ago. And at first there were no nibbles. And I went back to the Lord and I said, Father, this really, really needs to sell. Could you please send us a buyer? And somebody came and looked at it, and they liked it. And they came back and they looked at it. And then they looked at it again. And finally, in about September, they said yes. So we're thinking, ooh, the money's coming. It was delay after delay after delay. And finally, every time I hear, the money's coming, I think, right. Thank you, Jesus. Right. Well, we are so excited. Rod retired at the end of December. And I got worried that money would be really, really nice, because I've been praying to get out of debt. And we had whittled the debt down to where we only owed on two things. Our house, which was almost paid off, and a brand new car we bought. And I kept thinking every month, maybe this will be the month I won't have to come up with that money for the house payment. That didn't work. But on Friday, I think it was on Thursday, Marge, his older sister, called and said, the money's coming. And right away, I thought, But it came on Friday. She deposited the money in our account. And I just praise God. You know, sometimes our timing is different than the Lord's. And this morning I was making the bed and getting ready. And I thought, Father, if that had come sooner, we might have said, woohoo! You know, let's go on a trip. Let's whatever. Yeah, I probably have lots of best friends. But I just said, thank you, Lord. You know the timing. So if you're waiting, if you're praying, don't give up. It's coming. And, you know, the word to us was, this is the year of prosperity. And we know that prospering just doesn't have just to do with money, but it helps. It really does. And, you know, God wants his people to have what they need. But he also wants them to have enough so they can share with others.
Hallelujah. Well, we rejoice with Rod and Sharon in God's timing and provision. Amen. Well, we have so much wonderful things. Tammy, I'm going to wait till have you share next week that story. Okay, all right. Well, praise God. Since it looks like what time is it right now? Anybody, what time is it?
20 after.
20 after, okay. If you are here, this is your very first time visiting the river, would you raise your hand? We would like to go ahead and give you a connection card. We'd like to come to connect with you. So go ahead and you'll be handed a connection card. Please fill that out for us. Put in the offering, and we'd like to get to know you. What's that? Oh, well, please raise your hand, yes. Now, I do want to point out somebody that's here today that we haven't seen in so long. And so, Cecilia, would you stand up? She is here, for those of you, Cecilia was with, when we were Cornerstone, and so she's here with her new husband, who is going to stand up, and we are blessed to have them this morning, so yes, praise God. Well, if you would, go ahead and stand up, grab the person's hand next to you. Well, I don't know him, Lori. Well, you get a chance to get to know him today. All right, and let's just go before the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You're so good. Hallelujah. Well, Father, we come before you this morning, and Lord, we rejoice with the testimonies, Father, of your faithfulness and your provision and your timing. Father, we come before you this morning, and Lord, you prepare our way. Father, you make our feet assured of our steps, Father. And Lord, I just ask this morning that each and every one of us would have our ears open to hear your voice, Father, that we are readying ourselves to hear the commands of our Father, our Commander-in-Chief, Father, to go forth and to do what you called us to do. Father, we know that you're opening the doors, you're opening the gates, and Father, that provision's coming to do what you called us to do. So, Father, this morning, we thank you that you are preparing us for such a time as this. And so, Father, this morning, we give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor in Jesus' name. And everybody shout, hallelujah! Go ahead and let's start worshiping the Lord. Give the Lord a clap of praise. Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. I was uploading the video. Somebody said, when they go to the left and the right in the song, you should get a recording of it from back here. I said, no, I'm going to go hide behind the curtain. So I poked the phone out. Well, okay, because they were like, the people up front didn't know, didn't even see me. So I got it all. I'm thinking for a promo for our church. Here's what we do Sunday. Jumping with energy drinks, moving, you know. I posted that.
Born. Hey. I think you went for four.
Yep.
You are...
Right, I'm Brandon. Brandon, right.
Next thing.
Hey. How's your day?
It's getting better.
It's getting better.
It's good. Yeah. Unless it's already terrific, then you're probably higher.
Yeah. Maybe.
Yeah. Then it's illegal.
Okay.
It is illegal. Oh, you can go. So I did. I only really thought two words in my mind. Oh, dear. So I just said, you're right.
I'm learning, I just don't have Microsoft Publishing, so forgive me, as Shannon says, you can forgive me. I will try not to let it happen again among all the things that I forget.
Make it rain.
Well, it's that time of year again. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? It's tax season. Yeah. How many of you are gearing up to get them done or are on fire? You don't have to raise your hand. I've already done mine. Well, anyway, if we could get to our seats and shut the doors and come out of the lobby and everything, please, because this is important, what I have to say this morning. Thank you. Okay, we want to honor God's word, right? Okay. So, in the process of doing ours, and I did TurboTax online, I realized my husband made 34% more than last year.
Wow.
And you say, why are you bringing it up? Because we're going to talk about multiplication this morning.
Yeah.
You know, what everybody's been talking about prosperity and this year and that kind of thing. Kathy had put on Facebook about tithing off of your tax refunds.
Yeah.
And I thought that's really weird because we were thinking along the same line this morning about taxes. But anyway, I want to talk to you, like I said, about multiplication. In the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and John, there's an account of feeding the 4,000 and 5,000 by Jesus after he had been teaching the people were hungry. Because, you know, they didn't go an hour and a half like we do. They went hours and hours. And so we see in the Gospels the different takes or perspectives that Matthew and Mark and John have. So I'm not going to read every account because a lot of it's repetitive. So I'm going to bring some things out to you this morning. For those that haven't heard this before, I'm taking Matthew 14 about the 5,000 to read you the whole scripture. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the village and buy themselves some food." Jesus replied, "They don't need to go away. You give them something to eat. We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. "Bring them here to me," he said. And he directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate, were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. So more than enough, right?
Yeah.
The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's Matthew 14, about the 5,000. Then in Matthew 15, about the 4,000, his disciples answered, "Where could we get enough bread in this remote place to feed such a crowd?" Okay? And then Mark 6, 37, feeding the 5,000. This is Mark's take. But he answered, "You give them something to eat." And they said to him, "Well, that would take more than a half of a year's wages. Are we to go and spend that much on bread and give it to them to eat?" And then in Mark 8, the 4,000, his disciples answered, "But where in this remote place can anyone get enough bread to feed them?"
Yeah.
Okay, and then I want to sum this up because I'm trying to make a point here. It's in John 6, 5, verse 5 and 6, on his take of feeding the 5,000, that we see that it wasn't about Jesus not having the resources or the money to go and get stuff. Okay? It was about Jesus showing his ability to provide. Okay? And it's their response to, what do we do? How many of us feel like, what do we do? You know, what do we do? Okay. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, listen, he said to Philip, where shall we buy bread for these people to eat? He asked only to test him. I think sometimes when we read the word, we hear bits and pieces
stories, but we don't hear the whole thing from all of the word. This is important. He asked only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. God already has in mind what he's going to do. Okay? It is up to us to give him what we have. Okay?
Amen.
This is what God does with our tithes and our offerings.
Amen.
He lifts them up and he blesses them and he multiplies them.
Amen.
And it's to help us, his church,
Amen.
His body, to be able to proclaim his message to the world, to further his kingdom. That's the whole point of me sharing about, I noticed that Charlie made 34% more. That is God, people, okay?
Yes.
That is God. Because some people get a 5% or a 10%, but 34%? I was like, wow, man. Because we don't know how it works. I don't know how. I can't explain it to you, but it does. And the more you give, but we don't do it for that reason. We do it in faith.
Yes.
To connect with God's grace. Okay? So how many of you need an envelope this morning to give? Okay. And how many of you maybe feel led to give but don't have cash? We have debit card. Thank you for that word, form. Just keep your hands held high. My family in prayer this morning. I had posted on Facebook, but I know from experience that not everybody reads Facebook, or if you're not reading at the time something is fed into it, you're going to miss it. But my daughter in Colorado doesn't have children, and it's not by choice. She's believing God, but she has fervent needs right now. And a week ago, she called me and said, Mama, pray. She thought her little puppy falling off the bed, but it was something neurological, and within 3 days her little doggy was gone, and she's heartbroken. And then my other daughter, we just need to pray for her and her children. We need to pray for salvation. So that's Shannon and Ariel, please, this morning. Okay, we got everything we need. Okay, so what we do in our church is we worship, because tithing and giving is a form of worship. It's the first form of worship. And you just bring your tithes and offering to the back, okay, when we're singing. So how many of you are ready to give? Okay, look up. Father God, we come before you and we thank you and praise you that you are our creator. We thank you that you're the way maker. And there seems to be no way. We thank you, Lord, that you are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. That you are our all-sufficient God. Thank you, Lord God, for what you have done in this body and what you're doing on this earth. We thank you, Lord, for the things to come, Lord. We thank you how you're preparing our hearts and you're preparing our church. And we thank you for the harvest, Father. We just declare your glory over this earth. Father, we just ask that you bless each gift and the giver, and you multiply it like you do. And we give you all the honor and glory and praise. In Jesus' name. Yeah.
Savior, I come, cry to you. Thank you. Pursued other things, and you didn't realize that I put the answer in your hands. Now I want you to ask me what it was that I gave you that you set aside. And I remind you that it was a rock smaller than a man's hand that killed a giant. I have put things in your hands that you've yet put to work for the kingdom of God. How will you pray for more if you will not use what I've given you? I do not say this to your shame, but only that you might hear and understand that I get glory from the small things that you give to me. And when you give them, they become powerful in my hand.
stars to tremble at the light that you bring. You walk into the room. Every heart starts burning. Nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you.
Won't you let this be a sacrifice? Changed even unto eternity. So Father, we thank you. We We thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your presence. And we thank you, Lord, for each other. And so, Lord, we thank you in everything. And in all things, we thank you. And then we thank you some more. And then after we're thanking you, we thank you even more than that because you're a good God. And
more.
We thank you some more.
More.
And we thank you. We thank you. We honor you. We love you. We praise you. We glorify you.
Woo.
You are awesome. You are the car. You are the wheel in the middle of the wheel. You are the lily of the valley. You are the bright of morning star.
Woo.
You are the great I am. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end. There is none like and unto you. You are the Lion of the tribe of Judah. There is none like and unto you. You are the great and mighty one. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you came, you defeated death and hell, and you rose again on the third day, and interceded in heavenly realms. And we thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you for our salvation. We thank you for our freedom. We thank you, Lord, that you have delivered us. We thank you, Lord, that you are guiding us and leading us through your Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you're welcome in this place to do whatever you want to do. We'll not hold you back. We'll not tell you what you can and cannot do. This is your church. This is your body. This is your city. This is your state. This is your nation. You do whatever you want to do, Holy Ghost. We'll follow you. All we ask is that you make it very clear what you would have for our lives. Remove the areas that would stop us being able to hear from you and to follow you in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 All right. Everybody excited this morning?
Yeah.
You know, a long time ago, in the middle of revival, I was, I just want everybody to know, there's a lot of faces that I haven't seen in a while. I'm so thankful to see each and every one of you. It's awesome. And but I just have to get into what the Holy Ghost is saying. That's just who I am. So let me just do that. Long time ago when I was in revival, and I asked God, I said, what is revival, and, you know, what does it mean to have a move of God? And I had a vision. How many of you have seen a rain barrel before? I mean, like old school rain barrel.
Yeah.
You know, with the wood, and then it comes off, the water comes off, and, you know, and you look at the water, well, a few days after it's rained, and it's very clear, very pristine, and it's almost inviting that you want to drink from that. And then suddenly the Lord, I saw a stick go in and begin to stir it. And all the sediment from the bottom came up. And how many of you ever seen that before in a rain barrel before? I used to love doing it as a kid, you know, because it was cool to watch the big cloud just form. It was like a, you know, explosion went off. And the Lord said, that's what I do in the hearts of men. See, we want to be settled. We want to be settled with where we are and what we have and what's going on in our life. And we don't want any unrest. And we're looking for this, you know, this peace. And we're looking for this place where there's no suffering and no pain. But you have to understand, it's not going to happen here. Not quite all of a sudden. I mean, people spend millions of dollars to go find some place on an island somewhere so they can have seclusion and a bird shows up. And poops on their margarita. And all of a sudden, no longer do they have any more peace. Are you understand what I'm saying? We are trying to find something within our own power and our ability, and it can only be found in the Holy Ghost. You can have peace in the midst of chaos. But it's not anything that it looks like in this world. Hello? I'm going to need something this morning. I will start kicking a chair or something. I'll get something to aim in me this morning. Because I'm telling you, God wants to move in our hearts, but there's got to be a stirring that begins to happen to stir up the junk that we think that we've taken care of, and we haven't. All we've done is shoved it down in. All we've done is done everything we can to hide it so the crystal clear comes up, and everybody goes, oh, look, you got everything together. No. It isn't that I have everything together. It's that Christ is setting me free.
Yes.
It has nothing to do with being together. Being together is a fallacy.
Yeah, it is.
It's fake. We're not in control at the end of the day of our life. I mean, the only reason we have air to breathe is because God created it. Do you understand that? And we're going around thinking that we're in control of our lives, but God could supply the very neat thing that we need to take care of the air so that we can even breathe. And then he's the one that caused the plants to grow so we have food to eat, so animals can eat the food, we can eat the animals, we can have energy in our bodies so that we can do what we need to do.
Yeah.
But we're not in control, because if all that's removed, we're out of control. Then we come into the kingdom of God, we receive Christ into our heart. And then suddenly we think everything's just going to disappear bad out of our life. No, 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 no. Trials and tests, they come. And that is to prove and to build faith in us to trust God that in whatever we're asking for. So when we're asking God for freedom in our life, guess what he does? He purposely allows things to happen in our life to bring about freedom. Now, we may not like how it is happening because we're an entitled, spoiled bunch of people. And that's the truth. We don't want to suffer. How many of you like suffering? How many of you love freedom? Well, you can't have freedom without somebody suffering. Somebody has to pay the price for that freedom to come. My daughter does not have to worry about an electric bill, a gas bill, a roof over her head. She does not have to worry about buying clothes. She does not have to worry about any of those things. You know why? Because somebody has to pay the price for her to have that freedom. Yeah. But there's going to come a day when that freedom will change. Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? And in our life, we have to mature. We have to grow up someday. And everybody, but we're looking for handouts from God, for God to take care of things in our life. But he can't give you what he wants to give you because you will not manage and take care of and honor what you're asking for with where you're at.
That's right. Come on.
Now hear me. As much as my daughter wants to play with a drill, an electric drill, I'll be out in the garage doing something. She goes, Daddy, can I do that? And she really wants to, but as much as she wants to, she's not in a place of maturity to be able to handle that without harming herself. Are you hearing me? So therefore, she has to grow into maturity to be able to handle that responsibility. Well, it's no different than with us. Just because we're older and just because we have jobs and we have certain responsibilities doesn't mean we are mature. Help me out. I try to warn people. I don't know if anybody warned you if you're visiting here this morning. I don't know if anybody warned you, but if you're religious, you will not fit into this fellowship. This will drive you nuts here. It'll drive you batty in this place. Because, see, religious people, religious spirits have a critical spirit. And they try to find fault. They start fault-finding everything that's going on. And you will find lots of fault here. Because we're not ashamed. Listen to me. We're okay with everyone jacked up, and we're okay with everything not perfect and everything not flowing just professionally. We are family having church, amen? So God wants to bring us into a place of prosperity, but not many of us are ready to handle the prosperity. You would go, listen, you said, God, if you gave me $1 million, I would build a church, I would do that. I doubt it. If you got $1 million, man, you would be heading to the Bahamas looking for that margarita out on the beach so that you can find some peace. And a bird comes by and will poop in it. I'm telling you right now. Then you'll go, then I'll go build the church. I'm telling you the truth. I know because I've seen people that have done that. They didn't have anything. They came into money. And when they came into money, they blew all the money on stuff that really never, ever mattered. They never advanced the kingdom, even though they said they would. And then they wonder why they just got squandered away because they didn't honor their word. The word of God says, if you make a vow to the Lord, do not be slow to repay it, for surely the Lord your God will come after it.
Right.
It's better to honor your word or just shut up and not even give a word. Without putting some thought into it of what that's going to cost you. If you are not in the place of paying that, slow your roll a little bit and say, God, prepare me.
That's
right. Are you hearing me? God, prepare me to do that thing.
Yes, sir.
I want to honor you, Lord, but I don't know how to. It's all about being honest with God and coming into a place of saying, being real with where you're at with it in your walk with God and say, listen, God, I'm not ready for that, but you can make me ready for it. Prepare me. Seek my heart and see if there's any offensive way in me. Search me out, God. Know my heart, God. I don't know my own heart, God, but you know my heart, so I want to know my heart. So reveal, lay open the things of my heart that are holding me back from receiving everything that you have for me, that I could be a blessing to this world. Come on now. Are you getting something out of this? See, that's the stirring of the pot. When you're ready, when you're willing to say, God, put a stick in my barrel and stir up everything, he will be fast and furious with that prayer. You can pray for a Maserati and it'll take you 10,000 years and you might get a toy. I remember going to an exotic car showroom and they had a Ford Cobra. I love Ford, the old Ford Cobra 429s. I mean, they're just nice looking cars. And I went in there and I looked at that and I sat in it and I said, Lord, I'd love to have one of these. Yeah. About 2 months later, somebody came to me with one of those little metal models and said, the Lord told me to give this to you. I'm not kidding you. I'm not joking. They said, the Lord told me to give this to you. And it was a little toy model. And I was like, yeah, you're funny. You're funny, God. You know the Lord had to have a good time on that one. At least somebody was hearing from God. It was just the wrong size. Hallelujah. What's that? Yeah, the fishing pole, that old fishing pole, I'll tell you what. But if you have your Bibles this morning, throw me to Psalms 127. Because see, when God begins to move in our hearts and we allow him to move and stir, we have to come to a point of decision of asking ourselves, whose will am I following? We have to ask ourselves, whose will am I following? The Word of God says here in Psalm 127, verse 1, says, unless the Lord builds the house, its builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchman stands guard in. And see, because God is building your house, and you're allowing him to do the work in your heart, everything else you're doing is in vain. Not in this world. This world's going to recognize your hard work, and you may even get a raise out of it. But in the eyes of God, it's in vain. Unless you are yielding your will to his will, for him to begin to build something in your life, what you build is in vain. Yes. How many of you ever heard my story about the house that Phil built? One of you. Wonderful. So I can teach you a story about the house that Phil built. I met this guy. His name is Phil. And Phil built this house out of whatever he could pick up on the side of the road. Literally. He would drive down the road and he'd be like, step on the brakes, go in the middle of the road, pick up some wood that fell off of a truck, and he'd throw it in the back of his truck, and he'd go to build his house. Then he'd go to construction sites, and he'd get all the leftovers. And he was so proud of this place because he built it debt-free.
Amen.
And I went to his house. He said, I really want you to come see my house. So we went out to his house. And it was a pretty amazing sight. There was about 20 different kinds of siding. All kinds of different sized windows. None of the roofing was the same. Some metal, some asphalt, some, I don't know what it was. There was all kinds of stuff, right? And he was so proud because he built it free, because it was just stuff he picked up. And it had a little tiny door he walked. I had to go in it sideways, and I was a little bit skinnier then. And I went in there, and the roof was about this high, so the whole time I'm standing in the house, I thought I was on, you know, Lord of the Rings, and there was a hobbit house. I was really excited. And he had an ostrich farm, and so we had ostrich burgers. And we're sitting in the back. He goes, do you want to come upstairs and check out the upstairs? And I looked at the upstairs. The upstairs, to get upstairs, was about narrower than this chair. And so I said, no, I think I'll just stay downstairs. And everybody went upstairs, and as they were going upstairs, the whole house was doing this. And I'm thinking to myself, I'm going to go outside and look at the ostriches. The floors had linoleum and tile and I don't know, some other stuff that, you know, they have industrial stuff at schools, you know, that stuff. And they have all different colors, they have different patches of carpet around, I mean, different sides of wall. I mean, everything was just, there was nothing matching in the house. But it was debt-free. And he was so happy about this house. And as the Lord began to speak to me about the house that Phil built. And this is what we tend to do. Instead of allowing God to build us something that is beautiful, that takes a longer time, we just collect stuff as we go along. Oh, look, there's a revelation path for Pastor Dave. And we take that revelation that was for him, but we take it for ourselves. And we nail it to our spiritual house. Oh, look, Karen got a revelation from the Lord. That was for Karen. Not for you, it was for her. But because you don't want to do any work, you just grab whatever revelation God gave her, and you just nail it to your house. And you go down the line, and you read a book, and you grab somebody else's revelation. And you go over here, and you grab this revelation. And you go over there, and you grab that revelation. And you go around, and you start grabbing all these revelations all over the place that wasn't even meant for you. Because you never even prayed, God, what do you have for me? You just go, man, that sounds really good. Woo! Grab that thing. You're like, oh, step on the brakes. You hop out because it fell off their truck on the way to the meeting. And you grab that revelation and you just begin to nail it to the house. And you're so proud of your spiritual life. And you go around telling everybody, hey, check out my house. It didn't cost me anything. Got quiet all of a sudden, didn't it? And you're looking at the house and you're going, man, you have 30 different songs. Yeah, I got a revelation from this book, and I got a revelation from that book, and from this movie, and I watched this preacher over here, and I did this, and I did that, but you've never committed to any of the revelations. You just picked them up. Hello? I need, hello? Is there anybody here? Because they got dead quiet. The wind went out of the sails in this place. Some oxygen began to leave because it's the truth. We're not allowing God to build the house with us because there's a price that has to be paid for him to build that house. And we're building things that are in vain. They don't matter when it comes to eternity. They just impress people with our spirituality. Who are you trying to impress? People with your spirituality or God with your sonship? Come on now. Well, look how impressive I am. I can do this and I can do that. Well, I don't really care. At the end of the day, the Word of God says, if you do not have love, you are a resounding gong. You are a useless nobody. But to walk in love costs. You will be rejected. You will be shamed. You will be pushed to the side. You will be discounted. Come on now. But in the eyes of your Father, you're doing all the right things. Come on now, somebody with me this morning. We look at the house that Phil built, we're like, man, he did it debt-free, but in our spiritual life, there's a cost. Faith without works is dead. We don't do works to have faith. We don't do works just to gain faith. We have faith, so we do works. Because of the faith we have, we put to action what God has put in our heart. Therefore, we earn what God has given us. We can freely give what we have received from him. You understand? You can't just give away somebody else's revelation. It means nothing after a while. The next generation will not pick it up. They will not move into your house that Phil built.
That's right.
Are you hearing me? They won't move into it. And some of you are spiritual hoarders. God's trying to remove things out of your life and you can't let it go because it's part of your identity.
Because she warm. I don't know what happened.
This kind of message excites me. I get excited. I want God to pierce my heart. I want to leave church like I've been murdered, like somebody stabbed me right through the heart with the sword of the Spirit. I want to know that I can be changed. I want to know that I have hope at the end of the day because I'm going through hard times in my life, and I know that at the end of the day it's for a purpose and a plan.
Yeah.
God hates me. Because some of you believe you're going through stuff in your life because God hates you. He does not hate you. God loves you. And if God is love, then what he has in your life and what you're going through is for a purpose to bring you into prosperity and into life. But it has to cost you something. You can't just let somebody else pay the price anymore. You're going to have to suck it up and say, it is my responsibility to pay this price, and I'm going to do what God wants me to do.
Amen.
Oh, amen.
Come on.
Who's building the house? Who is building your house, actually? Who's putting it together? Is it just, you're just living off your mommy and daddy's house, spiritually? Are you living off of your preacher's house, spiritually? Are you living off of ancient time religion, spiritually? I don't know what you're living off of, but who's building your house? If God is building your house, and he starts to tear down what you have built, you can't have a cow over it. You can't be going, "Whoa, what are you doing, Lord?" If you say, "God, I give you permission to do whatever you want," and then all of a sudden mayhem happens, you got to believe it's God, and you got to trust him, and you got to thank him for mayhem. Thank you, Lord, for all of this going on, man. This is awesome, Lord. I'm so thankful all of this is falling apart all around me. That's what the word says. Be thankful in what? In all things. Some of you are cursing the wrong person. God, what are you doing to me? Stop cursing God. He's not your best interest in mind. Thank him and rebuke the devil. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. Submit to the work of God in your life. Resist the temptation to go out and do dumb. Come on now.
Yes.
And dumb will flee. It is important that we are not building each other's house. That is the job of the Holy Ghost. We go around trying to build each other. It's not my job to build you. It's my job to love you. I can't change your life. What has happened in the church is we become critical of one another. We're wondering why everything is falling apart in the church. It's not my job to build you. It's my job to, listen, supply you with building material. As a pastor, I supply you with building material, but it's up to the Lord to tell you where that's supposed to go.
Come on.
Does that make sense? But it is not my job to build it for you, because if I build it for you, then I reap the blessing of building that. Then it's not your house. You have to put bigger doors on for me. All my houses have double doors. It's pretty bad back in the day when I used to wear a pager, you know, and it would go off and the lady, people at the store would say, "Watch out, he's backing up."
Oh, my word.
It's awesome.
Oh, my God.
Philippians 3:17. Oh, that was awesome. Nothing like being a secure fat man and being able to tell jokes about it. All right, seven.
That's Batman. That's Batman.
Verse 7. Philippians 3, 7. But what also I profit now, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For whose sake I have lost all things. For whose sake I have what? Lost all things. And you think, well, that was Paul. No, this is for you. The reason he wrote this is for you. And for me. For Christ's sake, I lost everything. I don't consider that I know one thing. I've been doing ministry for 32 years, and every time I come into a meeting, I come into a meeting like it's the first time I've ever preached in a meeting. I don't just rely on my past experiences. I come into it not knowing what I'm going to say, what I'm going to do, or how it's going to happen. I come in here trusting God for whatever he has. I really don't know how to do it different. If someone tells me this is going to be the theme, I toil for weeks over themes.
I just got through preaching at a scene of faith, and the theme was, is am I my brother's keeper? And I mean, I was just toiled over that for 2 weeks. I was like, Lord, what does it mean to be my brother's keeper? I don't understand, God. I don't know what I'm doing. What a thing. How do I do this thing, God? What's going on? I mean, it was all the way up until right before church started, wasn't it, Pastor?
Yeah.
Pastor Dave. Right before church started. Then I was upstairs, and I go, oh, I get it now. But I had to lay down everything. I had to just say, I'm done. And I'll just wait, Lord. Whenever you're ready, I guess I'll do it. Whenever you want to do it, that's when I'll do it. Because I want to honor the people with the theme, and so I want to do what's right. But that's not how God created me. That's maybe how he created you, but that's not how he created me. We've got to consider all things loss. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
But whatever is to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. Verse 8. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ. Paul was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He knew the five first books of the Bible by heart. He killed Christians in the name of God. When he was Saul, he was passionate for God his whole life. And he believed what he was doing was righteous. He honored God in every way. And his whole life was just to honor God and live the law to the T. He said, as far as the law, I was perfect. Can anybody in this room say that? He could. Saul said, as far as the law was concerned, I was perfect. Amazing. And then on the road to Damascus, God knocks him off of his donkey. And God says, why are you persecuting me? And he has this total transformation in his life. He meets Ananias. Ananias, water baptism. He comes out, speaking in tongues. That's what it says. Then he was baptized in the Holy Ghost. And then he moved from there immediately to the synagogue and started preaching that Jesus was the Christ. He went from knowing everything, listen to me, to knowing nothing. What we've done in the body of Christ is we went to him into the body of Christ thinking we know everything. And we know nothing. When we approach God, we've got to approach God not knowing anything. In comparison to who he is and what he has for you. But we bring him things that he's already dealing with, but because it hasn't been dealt with in the way that we want it dealt with, we argue with him. Once you give it to God, consider it lost. Listen to me. Once you give whatever you're giving to God, consider it lost. Consider it done. Finish through. Don't worry about it. Don't fret over it. Don't have anxiety over it anymore. Walk as if it is there and it is happening right now. Begin to live in that way so that God can begin to mold you who he wants you to be. Very quiet in here. This is the quietest I've ever heard the river. I'm just going to let you right now. It's a little weird. It's like we hit a calm spot in the river. There's some eddies going on. You guys are like swirling around in your inner tubes, just kind of floating around. Verse 9. I know.
The rapids are coming.
And be found. I promise you, yes. And be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. In other words, everything I do comes from God. Every decision I make, every move I make, even conversation that I have. You know, I talked to the Impact School of Ministry yesterday on the giftings, your birthright gifts. And I talked about those things. And as I'm talking this, you know, people are going, well, you know, I'm not comfortable with Pastor Lou knowing my life. I don't know your life. But he does.
Yes.
He knows everything about your life. Listen, the the only reason that Pastor Jim, Pastor Shannon, Pastor Lori, or Pastor Lou has any insight into your life is because God has revealed it to us to give you the proper building supplies so that you can begin to build your house. The only reason I'm ministering this morning is for you. It's not to make me feel good. I'm ministering for you and for me. I'm preaching to me just as much as I'm preaching to you. Either we're growing together as a family, or we're growing apart. And we've got to understand that God is growing us together. He's knitting together something that is awesome and powerful to where we have unity in the body that is in this place, to where we cannot be broken. It doesn't matter how much the enemy comes in, because God will put the weak in the middle and surround them with the strong, and they cannot be destroyed. And what does this have to do with what I'm talking about? Everything. Because it's not my will, it's His will. And if we begin to live this life when we wake up in the morning and say, God, not my will be done, but yours. Your will, God. What you have today. I surrender everything to you. I consider everything a loss that I can gain Christ today. Everything. I put everything behind me. Everything. Today is a new day. Today is the day of salvation for my life. Today is the day of salvation for whoever I come across. Today is that salvation day. Is this making any sense this morning? We can hang on to whatever we want. You can hang on to offense and forgiveness and anxieties and shame and all those things. You can hang on to all the stuff that you ever want to hang on to. That's up to you. Have you ever hung out with those people before and you're really tight with people? And then one decided not to serve God anymore and they just wanted to not do what God told them to do. And the other one said, I'm going to follow what the Lord has. You ever had those relationships in your life? Yeah. And then they go down the road, and they continue to go, and you're looking at them, and you go, man, they're changing so much. And you're not changing, and your life is actually growing worse, but theirs is getting better. Has anybody ever had that happen in their life? And then you're going, if I only changed with them at the same time, I could be in a different place right now as well. That's because you're hanging on to something that doesn't belong to you. You're a hoarder. You're a spiritual hoarder. And the Holy Ghost came into your house. And He said, "That if this is my house, I don't want it in here anymore. It stinketh." And you said, but my daddy gave it to me. He hurt my feelings when I was 5 years old. My daddy gave it to me. Come on. And I can't forgive what he did. Meanwhile, everybody you know is going down the road. And blessings are falling on them, and God is moving in their life, and they're doing wonderful things for the kingdom, and you're sitting there going, but why are they getting it? I'm not. And the Holy Ghost is going, because you're a hoarder. And you're such a hoarder, you get to the place where you don't even recognize you are living in a hoard. Have you ever seen those shows? Those shows drive me nuts. You know why they drive me nuts? Because they never finish anything. It drives me nuts. And we hang on to things. And then an offense builds onto an offense because then a preacher comes and has a word of knowledge that you have an offense towards your father. And they say, the Lord showed me you have an offense. And you go, I do not. Now you're offended with the preacher.
That is so true.
It's true. Now you're offended with the preacher. Now every time you see the preacher at the store, you take your cart and you go to the next aisle. And you run into Sister Elma or whatever else, and all of a sudden she comes walking down the aisle and says, the Lord told me. I was praying for you last night. The Lord told me you have an offense with the pastor and your daddy. Oh. And then you're like, I am not! Now you're offended with your daddy, and pastor, and now Sister Alma. Now he goes down the line and just keeps on building and building, and you're a hoarder. You're just going and gathering offenses in your life. Come on. We do it with sin. We do it with sin. We hoard sin. We go and we do sin, and we look at sin, and we touch sin, and then we hold it, and then we take it, and we bring it home, and we have what we call a sin herd. Because sin reproduces after itself. Because you feed it, and you take care of it, and you clothe it, and you take, and it's pooping all over your house, and it's peeing on the curtains, and it's just all over the place, and there's sin hair everywhere. And then when people come to your house, you're looking at your house, God comes to your house and goes, "You got sin in your life." And you're going, "No, I'm not," because you don't recognize the smell because you live in it. Am I telling the truth this morning? I mean, as practical as I can with this. Not my will, but your will be done. It's coming to the place where you're going, "God, you got to take, my house isn't mine anymore. It's yours. You can tear it down to the foundation, because I know the foundation is Jesus. Because I know I'm going to heaven. But everything else, I've been building it as I go along, and I have no idea what I'm doing."
Exactly.
It looks like a 2-year-old just built a Lego house. Why did you put a window in the front yard? Because it fit. Why is there a door on the roof so that I can reach in? Okay. Why is there no doors or no windows? Because I didn't feel like putting them in. Is any of this making any sense?
Yep.
We're holding on to things. We're holding on to things that God doesn't want in our life. And we're wondering why we're not walking into prosperity. Because this is what happens, is you'll hear teaching on prosperity. Sister Karen will preach on prosperity. And you'll be up here going, "Well, they just want money." That's all you hear, is they want money. You don't hear that she's trying to get you set free so that you can walk in freedom to be a blessing to others. All you hear is they want money. I don't want your money. If I wanted your money, I would charge you a cover charge at the door. You'd have a little stamp on your hand. And then the ushers would have a black light as you walk in and say, "Check in that stamp." "Yeah, okay, you take your $20. Come on in. All the coffee is $5. And you have a minimum of one coffee. You got to at least buy one coffee." I mean, come on. This isn't a rave club. Are you hearing what I'm saying? We're not just coming in here trying to make money off of people. Are you listening to what I'm saying? Who wants you to walk into freedom in your life? That's the reason we teach on giving. But the problem is you're offended already because you think you deserve something that you're not willing to work for.
Wow.
You want God to bless you, but you've never tithed a day in your life. You want God, the prophet's coming out of me right now, so just listen up. You want God's blessing, but you never ever gave what he told you to give when he told you to give it. Come on now. You want to be healed, but you yourself haven't prayed for anybody else. You think you deserved all the prayer. I came to church and asked for prayer. Nobody prayed for me. Now you're offended. Now you're offended at your daddy and at the pastor and at Elma and the church down the road. The whole church, everybody in it. You're offended at all of them. And now you're offended because people want to pray for you. No wonder why God's not helping you. Then you get to a place you don't even read your Bible anymore. You don't want to read it because God reveals, every time you read it, reveals that you've got to get set free from that thing. So you just throw it on the shelf. You've got to consider everything a loss. Am I preaching to anybody this morning? Am I just preaching to me?
We hear you.
I hear you. I love you, honey.
Revelations chapter 2, verse 2, "I know your deeds."
Wow.
Revelations 2, I know, or 2, about a edition there, "I know your deeds." Revelations 2 in verse I don't know, let's throw in any there, repent, come and fight in the spirit. I know your deeds to the church in Thyatira. I know your deeds to the church of Sardis. I know your deeds to the church of Laodicea. I know your deeds. I have a feeling God knows our deeds. I think he knows what is going on in our life.
That's right.
I think he knows exactly where we're at and what we're struggling with. And I think he loves us enough that he doesn't want us to go through it anymore.
Amen.
He's reaching out his hand to pull you out of whatever you're in, and you're slapping his hand like it's a high five. Like, wow, high five, God, that's your hand, that's awesome. No, he's reaching his hand to pull you out of the miry pit that you've got yourself into. And he wants to place you on a rock. You know, when Moses once said, Lord, I want to know your glory. I want to see your glory. And God said, listen, I'm going to reveal my name, not just to my glory, but I'm going to reveal my name to you. But my face you must not see. Mm-hmm. And then he said, there's a place where me near me where you may stand on a rock.
Yeah. What?
Right on a rock, next to me. So he told Moses. He says, then I'm going to cover you with my hand and place you into the cleft of the rock. See, God is reaching out his hand to put you in a place of safety where he can cover you, where he can protect you, where he can guide you and lead you so you know which way to go so that you can follow him and not try to lead him. We've been trying to lead God instead of following him. Two ways you can cook a roast. You throw it in the microwave. And hope you eat it fast enough before it turns into a rock. And you're the only one that gets to enjoy it. Or you can slow roast cook it. And then everybody will want a bite. That's what God wants out of our life. And what God has for you is not going to come overnight, you bunch of elephant eaters. Change isn't going to happen instantly in your life. You got to yield to God. I know you're big, you're tired of hearing, but you got to trust the process that God has in your life. Even the hard stuff, when you're going through the hard things in your life, you got to trust that process that God has in your life. You got to trust that what he's doing is because he loves you, and he believes in you, and he has the best for you, and he wants to build a beautiful mansion that reveals who he is in your life, not who you are. You can be proud of your little house that's about ready to fall apart all day long, but ain't nobody want to come in and do it and visit with you and hang out and get to know your builder. I did not ask Phil for his building plans. Oh, this is awesome. Do you have some plans I can have for this thing? Because there was none. Are you hearing me?
No codes or inspections.
None. I do not know. Some things I'm too afraid to ask.
Probably came out of a wrecked airplane.
Huh?
Probably came out of a wrecked airplane.
He was an airline pilot. I don't know. He might
have been.
You know the ones you can't turn around in?
I know it's cool and all, but what I'm saying, the point that the Lord showed me in this whole thing is that we're taking things that don't belong to us. We're stealing. You got to get your own revelation of what God has for your life.
Correct.
And you got to position yourself to get that revelation. You're going to have to suffer a little bit to get that revelation. You got to get passionate for the things of God. You gotta get hungry, you gotta get thirsty, you gotta get desperate. You gotta press in, you gotta do the hard things, you gotta make the hard decisions. You're thinking that forgiveness makes everything all better in that person's life. All it does is release you from the control of that person in your life. You have offenses. Some of you have broken fences. Some of you have too many fences. Some of you are living in bunkers with turrets and landmines, security cameras. You're a preacher prepper. You're afraid a preacher's going to show up in your life. You're going to shoot them before they show up. The Holy Ghost knows where the back door is. He knows exactly where you live and what's going on in your life. He knows our deeds. And he loves us anyways. Isn't that amazing?
Amen.
It's amazing he knows the junk of our life. And he's willing to walk right in the middle of that junk, that shame. And he's not ashamed of you. And he loves you just for who you are and where you're at. It's not anything about you that he's ashamed of. Let's all stand. So I want to encourage you, you know, on Sunday nights, I teach what I preach on Sunday morning, and I go into more depth on what I preach on.
That's right.
And I want to encourage you to come. You say, well, you know, Super Bowl's coming up. Listen, we're going to have the Super Bowl right here on the screen. You can come next Sunday and bring your little lounge chair, whatever you got. You can watch the Super Bowl right here. Bring some snacks with you. Because I might be hungry. If you're here this morning, and this ministered to you, and you're ready to lay down some of those things in your life, and you're ready to clean house, you're ready to allow God to build your house, and that's you this morning. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. I'm just going to ask you to come on up. Come on up here. You ready to start letting God tear down the walls that don't belong to him? Reconstruct it when things be reconstructed. Change the things in your life that need to be changed. Rearrange what needs to be rearranged. It might mean rededication. It might mean that you want to give your heart to Jesus. Might mean that you are tired of being sick and tired of doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result, which is a form of insanity. By definition, that is insanity. Hallelujah. I love our fellowship. I really do. Love what God is doing and how he does what he does. I'm utterly amazed every week at what he does. He's an awesome God. Amen. I want to address one issue here, and it has to do with guilt. Those of you who come up, and even those that are out here, I want you to listen to what I'm saying right now. You cannot be motivated by guilt. And you cannot be motivated by shame. You have to be motivated because the Holy Ghost is saying, I want to change something in your life. If you are guilt-driven, you will get rid of that guilt in a moment, but like a hoarder, you will bring it right back again as soon as you leave. Because all you're doing it is to please man and yourself. You want a temporary fix. As your pastor, I am not looking for a temporary fix. I'm looking for a lifetime change. You have to yield to the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit draws you up here, that's one thing. But if guilt brings you up, then you need to surrender that guilt to him right now. And you say, God, I give that guilt to you. I will not be manipulated. I will not be controlled by guilt or shame today. I will only yield to you, Holy Ghost. That's it. Does it make sense what I'm saying? Because religion builds off of guilt and shame. Jesus builds off of the work of the Holy Ghost. Are you hearing me? The days of guilt and shame have got an end in our life as believers.
Come on.
We change because the Holy Spirit wants to change us, not because guilt overcomes us. Amen?
Amen.
We yield to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit says, I don't want that in your life. Then we go, I don't want it either. Because you can feel guilty about something that the Holy Ghost is not ready to set you free from. Do you understand that? He's got another area that he's dealing with so that you never have to deal with guilt ever again. You're looking, listen, you're looking at the cow that is in the room that's very obvious in your life. But what God wants to take care of is the mouse that brought the cow in your room. You don't even see the mouse that brought the cow in. Are you hearing me? But you want to take care of the cow because that's the biggest thing in the room. And God said, no, that's not the problem. The problem is this. Once I get rid of this, that thing will leave. But because of guilt, you're trying to get rid of something that God doesn't want to get rid of in your life yet. He wants to get rid of those little things in your life that are causing the big issues in your life. And so therefore, if you just yield to guilt, you will try to eat the elephant when you leave this room and you will choke to death on it. But if you let the Holy Ghost take care of that little thing in your life, like Jenga, he just wants to pull that one thing out and cause the whole thing to tumble. You're just trying to knock the whole thing over in one push. And he's going, no, wait, there's an easier way. Just take this one little thing out, right there, and the whole thing comes tumbling down in your life. Isn't that awesome? So when we pray today, I want you to, before we ever pray, I want you right now to yield whatever guilt and shame you came up here with to God. Yes. Say, God, I'm going to trust you for what you have in my life today. Not my guilt. I will not listen to guilt and shame. It is not my Lord. You are. I'm not moved by my emotion. I'm moved by your word and your spirit in my life. I want you to do that right now, however that is in your own words. Pastor Jim, is Pastor Jim in here still? Come on up here with me, Pastor. Bear witness with what I was just saying, Pastor. Now, all I'm going to do is this. I don't know what to pray for you. I'm going to have to get on the line individually, and you can get a word from the Lord, and it may happen. But what I'm wanting to do is literally come by, put my hand on you, lay hands on you, and pray for you, that God breaks what he needs to break in your life. So basically, I'm going to go along and say, I'm going to say, break it in the name of Jesus. Break it, break it, break it. I'm going to go down the line. It's the Holy Ghost's work in your life. You understand? I can't change you. This isn't a time for a counseling session. Sometimes when we go to pray for people, that's what it turns into. Go to pray for you, we start having a counseling session. That's not what this time is for. This time is to allow God to break something in your life. And you may not even know what it is until about 2 weeks from now. I'm telling you the truth. And in about 2 weeks from now, you're like, what changed? And the beauty about that is that you don't even relate it to what happened in this meeting. You just give glory to Jesus for it. And that's what I love more than anything else. I love the testimony of our fellowship that people feel loved at the river, not loved because of Pastor Lou. They feel loved at the river. That blesses me more than anything else because it has nothing to do with Pastor Jim, Pastor Lou, Pastor Lori, Pastor Shannon. That's good with you. So Pastor Jim and I are just going to go down the line. Simply lay hands on you and pray, break it in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor Lori, is Lori here still? She's out being ADD. All right. That's what she does. Pastor Shannon, are you available? You cannot? Okay. Michelle? She's coming. All right. All I want you to do is when you're ready, you pray that prayer. I just want you to raise your hand just like this. Just raise your hand just like this. All right. So I know. All right. Not only that means I surrender.
Yeah.
Let's go ahead, Pastor Jim. Let's go pray, okay? All right. You go that way, I'll go this way. We'll be back. Jesus.
I break it right now in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. I break it. I break it. In Jesus' name. I break it right now in the name of Jesus. Ghost! In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I break it right now. Ghost! 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 Ghost!
Now.
In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I break it right now in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Some people are saying, you know, is this one of those Pentecostal churches? Yes. It is. Are you one of those charismatic churches? Yes. It is. Are you a Baptist? Yes, I am. I baptize people. Are you? Are you? Yes. Yes. I'm a child of God. I do what the Holy Ghost says to do. Don't put a label on me. I live in Oregon. We don't like labels. In Jesus' name. And just so you know, if people fall, it's real simple. You say, why do they fall? It's real simple. Because they cannot stand. Ghost, right now. I break it. 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 Break it right now in Jesus' name. I break it right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I break it right now. Now. I break it right now in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Yeah.
Now. In Jesus' name. Go.
Screen. I want you to take 2 steps forward, please. Not that we expect people to fall, but if you do, we don't want you to land on something. Fair enough? In Jesus' name. 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 I see the Spirit of God saying, it's like you're standing on the cliff and you're looking up. You say, but I'm afraid. I have fear. You got to yield that fear to Him. You got to allow Him to take that fear from you right now. You got to allow Him to break it right now. I want you to let it go. 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 No longer will fear rule your life. Free right now. In Jesus' name. 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 Jesus' name. Free, 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 free. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Yes. Yes. Stop saying no. It's not going to work. It will too. Jesus' name. Listen, you're welcome to go and eat today. We're going to be eating together, and so let's go eat if you want to go eat. And then tonight at 6 o'clock, we have service again. I encourage you, if you've never been to a Sunday night service, to come and check out Sunday night service. All right? It's very intimate, very personal. You can ask questions the whole night.